jurisdiction, some provisions are made for infants and children to live with the primary caregiver, usually their mothers, in prison. These children are de facto deprived of their liberty, albeit indirectly. Available data on the prevalence of the phenomenon worldwide indicate that the number of children who live in prison with a primary caregiver runs in the thousands. The estimated number, based on the questionnaire survey and other sources, is 19,000 children. The possibility for a child to live with a detained or an imprisoned parents and the restriction placed on this practice in most jurisdictions is a very complex issue, with profound implications for the well-being and the development of the child. It is fraught with difficult and crucial considerations, starting from the question whether to permit such a practice at all. Further crucial considerations relate to the living conditions and the living situations of the child and the primary caregiver, the availability of non-custodial precautionary or punitive measures, the possibilities of alternative care, the suitabilities of prison facilities to accommodate young children, and also an informed assessment about how cohabitation in prison or separation from a primary caregiver can affect the child's emotional and developmental needs. In all such deliberation, the guiding principles for public authorities, for decision makers, should be to consistently view all decisions and outcomes from the perspective of the affected children as rights holders and not merely circumstantial victims of their caregivers' encounter with the criminal justice process. This entails a sustained focus on the four general principles underlying the Convention on the Rights of the Child, and in particular the best interest of the child principle as enshrined in Article 3. And the focus on how this can be reconciled in practice with the requirements of the criminal justice system. An overarching consideration emerging from the study is that detention and imprisonment of a primary caregiver should be always, if at all possible, avoided. Non-custodial measures should be always be considered and be given priority, if permissible in the given judicial context. If detention or imprisonment is unavoidable, then provisions, adequate provisions must be established for the care of the affected children, and adequate prison facilities must be ensured to safeguard the child's rights to survival, protection, development, and participation, both when least in prison and upon release. Findings of the study have been organized in relation to the relevant stages of the criminal justice process involving the primary caregiver, but affecting their children as well, namely pre-trial decision making, sentencing, admission and entry to prisons, detention or imprisonment, and separation and release, and then integration into the community. Overall, survey responses indicate that the situation of these children is being accorded significant attention at both regional and national level. But more needs generally to be done to establish formal procedures and mechanisms that will ensure an informed, individualized, and qualitative approach to the child rights and interests. As far as the first stage is concerned, non-custodial remand measures and sentences have been widely considered in view of the best interest of the child in both pre-trial and trial procedures, So allowing parents and primary caregivers to provide and care for their dependents. Alternative precautionary or punitive options have included house arrest, electronic monitoring, deferred sentences, suspended sentences, home detention, community services, or probation. All such measures should be also applied to minority groups or foreign nationals. However, national rules do not consistently ensure that the defendant's childcare responsibilities are taken into account when choosing and executing the sentence. On the other hand, pre-sentence reports, including child best interest determinations, should be a primary factor in the sentencing decisions, and sentencing remarks should, as a matter of standard practice, articulate how and what information have been obtained about the affected children and how this has been taken into account in the sentencing decisions. Judicial training should be ensured in this regard. As far as the second phase is concerned, most of the national laws of surveilled states pose explicit limits on the child admission into a place of detention, typically between 2 and 6 years of age, and also place the restrictions on the length of permissible stay. This decision to allow a child to enter into a place of detention rests with the orders of the parental authority, but in many countries requires a request by the mother and an authorization by judicial, social, or prison authorities, either separately or jointly. However, the criteria underlying these decisions vary a lot in state practice, and survey responses do not always clearly indicate which are the essential considerations in the given evaluations. Some countries refer explicitly to breastfeeding needs, to indicators such as the child health, the protection of child safety, the abilities to parenthood, or the relationship between the child and the caregiver before entering prisons. It is a general recommendation that states should avoid strict age limits and rather undertake a case-based, a case-specific determinations of the child's best interests. Essential considerations in this regard should include the physical and emotional well-being, the developing of a strong and early attachment to the mother, and breastfeeding, the possibilities for breastfeeding needs. Focusing on the living conditions of those children in places of detention, survey responses show that specific facilities such as mother-child units and other arrangements conducive to the growth and the development of these children are often lacking. And there is a great variation in regional and national practices in this regard, and much more should be done. In fact, the life situation of young children living inhabiting prisons should be as far as possible normalized, so as to allow for maximum bonding between the child and the primary caregiver. The same similar minimum standard should pertain to the contacts and the relations of the affected children to the outside world, namely the affected and the extended family. If and when times come for separation of the child and the primary caregiver, due to age limits on imposed on cohabitation in prison, this event must be carefully prepared well in advance of child departure, and adequate provisions must be established to guarantee a continuous contact between the child and the caregiver. Usually the decision pertains to judicial or prison authorities in coordination with social welfare institutions, either jointly or separately, and the child is generally given to the father or another relative as a matter of first priority, but when this is not possible, judicial or administrative authorities can also intervene to provide alternative care. However, the best interest of the child is not always considered in state practice in relation to this phase, and a review of the chosen alternative option is not rigorously undertaken. In some countries, there are no explicit policies for preparing separation, while in others, a sort of support to both the mother and the child is provided according to available means, including through counseling on the psychological and emotional effects on the separation, and also the enrollment in social programs. This may be done in cooperation with child protection institutions, educators, NGOs, and this may be represent a good example for other states to follow, but more needs to be done in order to in fact ensure and facilitate a continuous contact with the child and the imprisoned parent following separation. Overall, states are responsible to develop a coherent and functional policy framework in all of the above regards. They should ensure an adequate capacity building for institutions and professional actors engaging with the affected children, and must allocate sufficient resources to address meaningfully their needs and interests. On the other hand, NGOs and other private actors have an important role to play in safeguarding the rights of the children who live in prison with the primary caregiver, and should be promoted and supported by the governments in this work.